Our first speaker is Catherine Adoyo at Georgetown University, who's going to speak about reading Dante from space.
Good morning. I'd like to say that I'm deeply honored to have been invited to participate in this conversation. Although it's a topic that is fraught with the danger of a lot of tightly packed experiential baggage, years of trying to reconcile my very uncomplicated love and admiration for the poetry and music and art of Italian provenance with the uncomplicated disdain and even hatred that residents of that peninsula thrust upon me whenever I walked on their land has often driven a part of me into self-preserving hibernation. The bright-eyed marvel that coursed through me the first time I stood before Michelangelo's David in the Galleria dell'Accademia, lingering close to it for nearly 8 hours, drinking in the living meaning of the words inspiration and ineffable, the sustained epiphany that Francesco d'Assisi's Cantico delle Creature ignited in my intellectual and spiritual universe, the perfect synaptic harmonies that resonated in my brain to the voice of Dante's Commedia, all of these and more were nearly snuffed out when an apparently affable man, unknown to me at the time, and since then rendered unrecognizable by the defenses of my psyche, sat beside me at the University Cafe in Perugia with the standard greeting of ciao, bella, and then proceeded to inquire, unctuous and intent, quanto? Perhaps you can forgive an undergraduate exchange student for not comprehending immediately. When you are busily and blissfully immersed in the experience of seeing known and forgotten coffee table masterpieces come to life, not just in galleries everywhere, but seemingly around every corner in Italy, it does not occur to you to develop any kind of response or defense against unwanted propositions. Once I understood, after the man's solicitous elaborations, that he had initiated a business negotiation by first inquiring after hourly rates and services included, I excused myself very gently, gathered my books, and bolted. The heartbreak and trauma only came later after I arrived home and told my Italian mamma, I lived with a Neapolitan family, my Italian mamma and fratelli, what had happened. It was not their amusement upon hearing my story that cut me. It was their carefree explanation for why I had been propositioned in that way. Magari, qui in Italia, le donne africane sono prostitute. They offered no further elaboration and dinner continued in mirth and merriment. For a time, I became consumed with navigating the minefield of casual gazes and encounters, trying to parse elements of popular imagination to find ground that would not detonate under my feet. These previously innocuous ciao bella calls, tossed about so casually in the streets, now filled me with dread and nausea. I did not look up when I braved the gauntlet of Corso Vanucci between the pensione where I lived and the university. Qui in Italia, le donne africane sono prostitute, rang in my head repeatedly. I did not want to be that donna africana. When my program ended, I left with no intention of returning to Italy ever. And yet, it is Dante's Commedia that saved my life, my mind, my sanity, my soul in those crucial first weeks following my encounter with that intimately disturbing detail about the Italian popular imagination with regards to African women. As I recovered from the shock in the following weeks, I could not resist the resonance of the synaptic harmony struck by that poem. So I gave myself to the perfect music of the Commedia long before I knew it was a music. I gave myself to the trinity of benefactors, Maria, Lucia, and Beatrice, who watched over Dante's soul and intellect, advocated for them and bore them aloft, guided and instructed them from the smallness of quotidian dramas to the grandeur of big questions. I gave myself to a vision of the earth as seen from the heavens, this modest home to countless potentially noble souls who nevertheless somehow seemed to always tangle themselves in small and mean vanities. Humanity, beheld from among the stars, could choose to be just as sublime as the cosmos in which its planet danced. I accepted Dante's invitation, proffered repeatedly and sincerely, to engage in the intimacy of intellectual query and discovery as an active interlocutor, because I preferred the beauty of that music to the brutality of a superficial idea of my person that saw me as an exploitable commodity. I accepted Dante's invitation because to Dante, I was, and I am, the lector to whose empathy the narrator of the commedia appeals in moments of particular pathos. Pensa, lettore. Se io mi sconfortai, eccetera. Se Dio ti lasci, lector, prender frutto di tua lezione, or pensa per te stesso come io potea tenerlo viso asciutto, eccetera. I am the lector he confides in and turns to when the memories of humanity's self-inflicted plight becomes unbearable. Per le notte di questa commedia, lettor, ti giuro. Oh, tu che leggi, udirai nuove ludo. Se tu sei or lettore, a creder lento. Com' io divenni allor gelato e fiocco, nol dimandar, lettor. I am the lettor whose intellectual discernment he calls upon time and time again. Pensa oggi mai per te. Sai fior d'ingegno. Aguzza qui, lettor. Ben gli occhi al vero. Non vo però, lettor, che tu ti smaghi non attender la forma del martire. Pensa la successione. Pensa. Lettor, tu vedi ben com'io innalzo la mia matera e però con più arte non ti maravigliar s'io la rincalzo. I am the lettore whose memory and intellect he trusts to envision what he envisions. Ricorditi, lettore, e fia la tua immagine leggera. Lettore, leggi Ezechiel, e quali troverai nelle sue carte, tali eran quivi. Time and again, he binds us in empathy. That is, he binds me and him in empathy. Pensa, lettore, se io mi meravigliava. Teases anticipation. Pensa, lettor, se quel che qui s'inizia non procedesse, come tu avresti di più savere angosciosa carizia, e per te vederai. And is frank even with his most vulnerable hopes. Se io torni mai, lettor, a quel divoto trionfo per la quale io piango spesso, le mie peccata e il petto mi percuoto, tu non avresti, intanto tratto e messo nel fuoco il dito, in quanti io vidi il segno. The most beautiful thing about the subjective correlation between narrator and reader that the commedia establishes is this: when the moment arrived, when this lettore that he's been talking to is actually described, and every reader of Dante discovers that the poet has been cultivating this relationship specifically with them. Without prejudice. Leva dunque lettore all'alte rotte, meco la vista dritto a quella parte dove il moto e l'altro si percuote. Vedi come da indi si dirama l'obliquo cerchio che i pianeti porta per soddisfare al mondo che li chiama. Or ti riman lettore, sovra il tuo banco, dietro pensando a ciò che si preliba, se esser vuoi lieto assai prima che stanco. Messo tu innanzi, ormai per te ti ciba, che a sé torce tutta la mia cura quella matera ond'io son fatto scriba. Dante's reader is possessed of a gaze that contemplates the heavens, a body that is seated, and a mind that has feasted upon the poem's manna. It is in this capacity that I gave my first scholarly presentation at an international conference on Dante and the Christian imagination in Toronto. I knew that the findings of my analysis would be heretical vis-a-vis conventional wisdom in Dante studies, but I took my scholarly responsibility seriously and was prepared to be held accountable. The presentation was well received, but there was one sticking point from several members of the audience and subsequently the gatekeepers of the tradition for some time afterwards. And it went something like this, quote, Some of the best minds have worked on this text quite thoroughly for nearly 700 years, and they all agree that this passage is indecipherable. Who are you to say otherwise? It was not the first time I'd heard the question, nor would it be the last. I understood the significance of authority here and knew that for many reasons, not the least of which was that I was a newly minted PhD with a dissertation still warm off the presses, I had no ethos or accumulated cachet of credibility to draw from. So I answered the best I could, explaining that in my responsibility as a collaborative reader in direct dialogue with a narrator, it behooved me to strip away the overlain centuries of obfuscating commentary that first affirmed the impenetrability of the passage while also ensuring that the text remained impenetrable. What remained was the lucid imagery the poet had taken such great rational pains to compose. What has any of this to do with diversity, you may ask? Well, in the years since, I have discovered that the state of Italian studies and perhaps other areas of academia may most poetically be described by a passage in The Little Prince by Antoine Saint-Exupéry, where the narrator finally deduces the location of the little prince's home planet. I had serious reason to believe that the planet from which the little prince came is the asteroid B612. This asteroid had been seen only once in 1909 by a Turkish astronomer in the telescope. He had then made a great presentation of his discovery at an international astronomy congress, but nobody believed him because of his Turkish attire. Fortunately, for the public awareness of the asteroid B612, a Turkish dictator compelled his people under penalty of death to dress in European style. The astronomer returned to resume his presentation in 1920 in very elegant formal wear, coattails and all. And this time, everyone shared his opinion. Whether we read the Turkish dress as different culture, different identity, different mode of thinking, Italian studies should not require the Turkish dictator's intervention to appreciate the discovery of B612. It will be richer for it. The world will be the more hospitable for it. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Nicolino Applauso, Morgan State University, and he will be talking to us about African Americans and the future of Italian studies. Teaching Italian in historically black colleges and universities in the United States.
Well, first, I would like to first and foremost to thank Dr. Antonio Tamburi, for having us here and the Italian American Institute together to put this wonderful event. I think is not very common to have the chance to discuss about this very important topic that affect Italian studies. And this also has been a very lively and engaging, as well as instructive symposium. So thanks to all the speakers that were here yesterday and are here today. And also would like to thank Loyola University Maryland for the financial support to come here. And of course, Morgan State University for having the Italian program. Now, it is very important for all of us investing in higher education and above all in the teaching of Italian studies to understand what lays before us. In a time, as Danny mentioned yesterday, when 50 plus Italian programs in a few years are no longer in existence, and every year, one by one, it seems like the other Italian programs are next, maybe. So you start to get a little worried, no? So I'm delighted to contribute today with some positive news for the Italian studies community, for Italianists, of a new Italian program, which came about fairly recently, in fall 2018, from scratch, last semester. And it's also important to note that it was established in a place where you don't usually find Italian studies. And this might give us a little bit of hope for the future of our discipline, but also food for thoughts. Because to my knowledge, this newly created program is the only Italian program that is currently taught in historically black college university across the United States. And I did check with Howard University, Spelman College. We'll probably have more to say about this in the published version of this article. Now, before going any further, I would like to dedicate my talk, since it was mentioned yesterday, to my mentor that I'm sorry he wasn't able to come today, but I hope he's watching, Dr. Raymond Fleming. Dr. Raymond Fleming, as you have mentioned, was one of the first, if not the first, African-American to ever graduate in comparative literature with a concentration in Italian in the United States. Now, I don't know if he's listening today, but Dr. Fleming is the mentor that I would like to recognize. It was not Umberto Eco, although his lectures were very interesting, University of Bologna, not other like Fausto Curi, of course, a mesmerizing speaker, but the one who made me fall in love with Dante was him. He encouraged me to push the envelope, and he had the crucial impact on my decision to venture in this field and become what I'm still, you know, trying to do, begin establishing this field of academia. And I was very happy to hear Dr. Fleming about the creation of this new program, Morgan State University. But I also received a good amount of positive remarks when the news came out from the fellow colleagues across the United States when this also was made public. Now, first of all, I think we should take a little time to go over what is an historical black colleges and university, because I went to a lot of conferences, and sometimes the same term, this term is not mentioned quite very much often. So just bear with me a few minutes. Hopefully I can make this presentation last 10 minutes, I think, maybe. But very briefly, what are historical black colleges and university? So, first of all, the abbreviation HBCU, as you all know, are institutions of higher education in the United States that were established before the Civil Rights Act of 1964, that you all know ended, or we all know as segregation. Now, the intention of primarily serving the African-American community, they were not allowed to attend this university, but also to create a space that was safe. In the same way as, you all know, some private liberal arts colleges, not this quite the same, but like to create this environment of protection. For African-American, the situation is far more serious, as you all know. And later on, the intention was to offer accredited and high-quality education to African-American for an affordable price. It's still, these great institutions still do offer excellence in academic. Today, there are about 107 HBCUs throughout the United States with more than 228,000 students enrolled. 56 of them, of this institution, are under private control, and 51 are public colleges and university. We also have ranking for HBCU. Now, I first learned about historical black college and university when I was teaching Italian at Florida State University. This is one of the most renowned historical black college and university there, the FMU, Florida A&M Agriculture. And I have evening classes there. You may not have heard of historical black college and university because they have their own ranking. And, And also, I also find this something that may connect to our topic, because parents, when they are deciding, and I'm talking about any types of part of any heritage, of any ethnicity, they tend to, you know, go online or maybe buy this Fisk guide to colleges. Now, historical black colleges and universities, they're not in the, we'll say, on the list right at the beginning. They're usually are in appendices in their own category. So they're often secluded in the HBCU category on the back of college guide, but HBCU are on the rise. This is something, these are the category for Spelman College is number one, Howard University, Hampton University, and of course, Morgan State. We have a sort of black renaissance in HBCU, and we are experiencing as a, also affiliate, as a member of this community. So as you can see, the enrollment is skyrocketing, 165% here, just to give you some number of growth, 162% of increase Spelman College from 5,000 now 8,000 enrollments. So we can talk about why this is happening, but of course, two things. The academic program, the rigors, and the fact that also they're affordable. And Morgan State, just briefly, has been ranked one of the best music program in the country. As you know, President Obama invited them. They were chosen to do the Macy Parade. You see them in here. And the engineering program is one of the best in the state of Maryland. And this is a doctoral Carnegie classified doctoral research institution, providing institution to multi-ethnic, multiracial student body. And now let's go to talk a little bit about this program. Now, how this happened? Well, my experience in historical Black college university in Florida was a play as well, but I was teaching Spanish at the historical Black, at the Memorial State University. And I proposed the Italian program. Now, another important thing to say, there was a need and an interest for the Italian program. It's not like somebody just came in, let's make an Italian program. The music department wanted Italian for a very long time. So the Italian program was established. The news went out, and as you can see, Morgan State were recipient, were happy to report about this program. Also, on a national level, we had the Journal of Blacks in Higher Education that were also happy to report this news. I reached out to Howard University, Spelman. Howard University, they used to teach Italian in the 1970s, I believe, but not anymore. They used to teach Italian because of Snowden. I don't know if you know him. He's a very important work. And not Snowden, the NS, is the famous classicist scholars, the one who opened a new field for Blacks in antiquity. But now, what is this a big deal? It is a big deal because, as you can see from this slide, African Americans comprise of 63% of the population of Maryland, over 600,000 people. You know, if you're from Michigan, there's 84% of African American in the community, in the state. Mississippi, we are number five. So it is important. And it's also important to bring out politics. As you know, we were mentioning the Blasio and his son Dante, right? I think. And perfetto, 2 minutes. The African American community is prominent. And I lived in six different states. I taught Italian in Florida, Oregon, Colorado, Pennsylvania, Maryland, and Virginia. I met a lot of different people in different states. I get to know different communities. But the African American community in Baltimore, especially, well, Maryland, I will say, but is unique because there's a long history. Now, I don't want to go over names, but you know, Freddie Douglass, Banneken, we have a great heritage. And the Italian American community, especially for the father of Nancy Pelosi, D'Alessandro, created a lasting legacy. Now, the mayor is a Morgan State University graduate, Catherine Pugh. And we met her before when discussing the Columbus situation. As you know, we have the oldest monument commemorating Christopher Columbus in the world, in Baltimore, built 1792 by the French consul. And we were talking with them about some issue. I sent also a letter connecting the situation with lynching. Because as you know, in 1892, many statues of Columbus were created strategically funded by Italians to avoid what happened in New Orleans in 1891, when we had the largest mass lynching in the United States in one day of Sicilians. Maybe Sicilian, that's the closest way you can get to African American. I'm Sicilian, so I guess that that may. So going back now to this connection. Now, I taught, as I mentioned, in large research institute, small private liberal arts. It's a little different, the culture. Now, if I had here all African American audience, will be a different discussion. And it's a different, and the pride also, when you teach in historical Black colleges, is there. And as an aficionado, as an admirer of African American literature in general, I can utilize this in my teaching. So I create classes that are to keep the program. This is the first semester. I had the student involved. cooking classes. We make bread, cannoli. Music is a very important part of the class. And mentorship. We were talking about curriculum, but I think teaching starts in a way when we mentor our students after we figure out what they want to do with their career. And many of my students are from the music department, and they want to teach and become music teachers. So I'm working and trying to model this Italian learning with a future career. And as you know, this is... and recently some good news. There was architecture, it's an Italian faculty reached out to me to create a study abroad program in Venice. I also want to show you some of the discussion we're having in Morgan State. There's a lot of talk about discrimination, but not so much at the beginning. When I teach sometime in other university, we spend about sometime 20 minutes trying to convince the audience about prejudice. You know? At historical Black College University, I find it more refreshing. You don't have to convince the audience about it. You just go to it and you explore it. So we had a discussion about study abroad in Germany. The topic of prejudice in Italy came up. And of course, if you're African-American parent, you know, the discussion is not so much about complaining about it, but doing something about it. So teaching your children how to avoid, how to navigate around this situation in the same way that Italian from African descent do when they wear the shirt. I'm not a straniero. So again, some of the African-American students identifying as from the United States, they are treated differently. And there is an example of prejudice and racism that is good to teach to the students. And to conclude, now there is also challenges because the material that we have to teach Italian, especially I don't think we are prepared yet, or we weren't thinking perhaps of this program, because the textbook is not, they're very different from the one that are offering French, German. When I teach Italian and I use Sentieri, the representation of Italians with a darker complexion, they usually relate to immigration, you know, and only the Italian were speaking, they're always with a lighter, you know, lighter, I would say, from a Norman descent, or Longobard, I'm not sure. I don't see many Sicilian or African, Italian-African descent. But anyways, this is different from French and Chinese. Now, Chinese includes a discussion, as you can see here, they talk about a Chinese student is talking to an American student. And you can see the representation of the American student at the restaurant. In the French, there's a blog. It's different in French study because, you know, Italian is connected also to some African country. But in Italian, I think there's still work to be done for that. But anyways, to conclude, my time is up. Sorry about that. New possible connection. Could and should be created because there is a lot of pride in historical Black College and University, and we have to find, I think, practical way to help our students to find employment, very important, but also to feel pride and utilize their interest. And this is some example, Dennis Looney. We also have other works by John Gennari. I mentioned Snowden, but also, you know, Fred Kuornu. They are very important agent in this. And create bridges with the community. I open a school. This is my school, Applauso Italian Learning Center. I help students of all ethnicity, and we have a couple here that are going to move to Italy because their business is now going to be headquartered in Italy. As you know, there's a shortage of teacher, foreign language teacher, and there's a critical need of Spanish teachers, so much that you don't even need to do a test. You just go at the high school and teach. And here in... And then later, they get your accreditation. In Baltimore, there's a lot of Italian programs in the high school, and I'm in touch with the council. We need teachers. So whether we get it from historical Black College University or other institution, but there is a need. So this is my talk. Also. I'm sorry, I went over, and thank you, everybody. Final connection. Between Italian and African-American study, Porgy and Bess. You know very well George Gershwin wanted to create something national to unite us all. Where he went? Folly Island, where all the Americans were screaming, and the freed slaves, you know, the Americans as well. And he came out with this idea of Porgy and Bess, written in the language of America. Thank you.
Nicholas Boston, City University of New York, Lehman College. Cosmopolitanizing, Ethnic Area Studies, A View from Polish Studies and Italian Studies. Welcome.
So good morning, and thank you for coming, and thank you to Catherine and to Nicolino for those wonderful... Can everyone hear me?
Yes, yeah? The other microphone.
This is the one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. All right. thank you. so I'll just dive in. But to conclude what I was saying for your presentations, and you'll see that there's an intertextual sort of like a quality to all of our presentations thus far, obviously since we were placed together, but to the point of actual images, as you shall see. So my presentation is called Cosmopolitanizing Ethnic Area Studies, A View from Polish Studies and Italian Studies. What I'm going to do, in fact, is to talk about a paper that I'm working on, and that is called Italy's Mahogany Paradox, Black Women, Esterophilia, and National Belonging. Now, and here's the intertextual part of it with the images. We just saw this. So on October 23rd, 2018, the New York Times published an opinion piece titled My Very Personal Taste of Racism Abroad by Nicole Phillip. Ms. Phillip is a digital editor at the New York Times. She is also, to quote her own words in the piece, an African-American woman with skin the color of dark chocolate and full lips, end quote. In this essay, Ms. Phillip describes the repeated encounters she had in Italy with various manifestations of anti-black racism while she was a college student on a semester abroad program based at NYU's Florence campus. The most blatant incident was when a man allegedly threw beer on her and another black woman on a beach in Cinque Terre and called them, quote, disgusting black women, end quote. The incidents took place 5 years previous in 2013. This timing, it seems to me, is significant, and I shall return to discuss why shortly. Thinking as both a journalist and scholar who is plagued by both vocations' insistence to clearly articulate a justification for what one writes in terms of its temporal relevance and spatial significance to a larger corpus of knowledge, the question arose to me, arose in my mind the first time I was reading through the piece, why now? The answer to this question comes at the very end of Ms. Phillips' article, when she reveals that at the time of her writing, she was preparing to take a return trip to Italy, this time out of a sense of obligation, not choice. So she writes, quote, to my surprise, two of my black friends who had studied in Rome in another college program had a great time that semester. One actually met her Italian fiancé there. I don't know what made the difference in our Italian experiences. Was it a more cosmopolitan Rome? I can't say. My engaged friend is getting married in Lamezia Terme, a city in southern Italy. So, 5 years later, I'm returning to the country that left a deep scar on my heart, end quote. There are obviously a great many phenomena that call out for critical attention in this piece. I wish to focus on two and their relationship to one another, a relationship that has not been taken full account of by scholars, simply because it is empirically elusive, yet it thrives in personal anecdote and popular culture. I've underlined the two phenomena that are this relationship's constitutive parts as they appear in Ms. Phillips' text. They are the notion of cosmopolitan or cosmopolitanism, and then the fact of the attraction between her black female friend and a presumably white Italian man, which has led to their marriage, which in turn is the event that is taking Ms. Phillip back to Italy, a place and people she dreads. We see already a paradox of attraction and repulsion forming. Of the nearly 300 comments made in the reader comments section of the article, a number draw attention to this paradox. So, one reader writes, quote, I'm sorry that happened to you, sister. This story is interesting because it's common knowledge among black women in the US that Italian men love black women. The story of your friend marrying an Italian is something that also happened to a friend of mine while studying abroad in Italy, end quote. She then goes on to say some other things that are not immediately of relevance. Another reader wrote, quote, "My casual observation while living both in Spain and Italy is that many Latin men are attracted to black women. I notice black women in either country have no problem finding a boyfriend," end quote. Now, a 2008 article in the Milan-based daily Corriere della Sera proclaimed there to be a, quote, "mixed couple boom in Italy." One in seven marriages, it observed, included a partner who was non-Italian. The article quoted figures showing that mixed marriages in Italy tripled in just over a decade, from fewer than 10,000 in 1992 to nearly 30,000 in 2004, constituting 8.8% of all registered unions. In 80% of these unions, the article noted, it was an Italian man marrying a non-Italian woman. Now, this gender combination is in itself intriguing because it is the inverse of trends in many other Western nations. In the United States, for example, white female and black male marriages outnumber the reverse by a ratio of almost 2-1, according to the Census Bureau. In the United Kingdom, 48% of African Caribbean men are in interracial marriages compared to 34% of African Caribbean women, according to the UK Office of National Statistics. A study of Europe-wide mixed marriages conducted by Giampaolo Lancieri, a lead researcher for Eurostat, the European Commission's statistical body, found that Italy was among the nations in which native-born men intermarry with foreign-born women at a higher rate than the opposite. However, in which Italy, the question remains, do these partnerships transpire? Are there regional, social, or class contingencies that support or enable these couplings? Quote, "Once it was seasoned travelers or intellectuals who contracted mixed marriages," said Mara Tognetti Bologna, a sociologist at Bicocca University who studies interethnic and interracial unions in Italy. "Today, with widespread, large-scale immigration from Eastern Europe, Africa, and Asia, they're available to everyone. The affective or psychosocial conditions in the nation underpinning the mixed couple boom, as it had been termed," Bordogna opined, "is that Italian people, particularly men, are, quote, looking for more openness, freedom, freshness, and contrast," end quote. However, she asserts, mixed marriage extends beyond the choices of the individuals involved. Interracial slash interethnic coupling, quote, "transforms institutions, making intercultural exchange the norm and opening up new opportunities for society. It is a major challenge to our rules of culture, kinship, and engagement." So in 1996, when Denny Mendez, a then 18-year-old Afro-Dominican woman, was crowned Miss Italy, the Italian press was quick to note that she had not been born on Italian soil, but had moved to the country as a child when her mother married an Italian citizen. One judge presiding over the contest, Enrico Mentana, a prominent television producer, said of Mendez to a New York Times reporter, quote, "She is exotic, like the women whom Italians who spend their vacations in Cuba find attractive," end quote. So American popular culture has seized on the notion of the Italian man slash black woman romantic couple, producing a lineage of references to it and representations of it. Most recently, a reality television program called To Rome for Love followed five heterosexual African-American women ranging in age from 25 to 52, relocated to Rome with the express purpose of finding an Italian male partner with the guidance of a relationship coach named Diane Valentine. I was in Italy at the time that I learned of this show. Thank you, Ryan, for informing me about it. We were in Calabria together at that point. That I learned of this show, and in the hopes of both taking my students in the course I was teaching at the time, and the course was called entitled Race and Gender in Film and Television, as well as to do some ethnographic research of my own, I contacted Ms. Valentine. And she responded enthusiastically, apologizing that the show had just recently concluded production and she and the cast and crew had already returned to the United States. However, she did kindly answer the main question I put to her, and what she wrote was, "Wow, I cannot wait to read your study. I fell in love with Italy during my first trip about 20 years ago, so I have traveled all over the country often. And my biggest memory is the amount of attention I would always get from Italian men. Regardless of the rumors, I was never treated inappropriately or disrespected by any of the male suitors, just showered with compliments and plenty of interesting offers. Once our show was created, I am the one who pushed for it to shoot in Italy for this reason, long before the title was Love Italian Style. Initially, the proposed title was Love Italian Style. When it did air, it aired under the title of To Rome with Love. My hope is that our show will be transformative for black women who feel invisible in the US when all they want is the attention of black men. I hope it will build them up and show people just how desirable black women are. Now, one of the episodes showed one of the women beseeching Ms. Valentine, can you please just bring me a black man? In the end, she found her own man. He was a graduate student from Senegal, and they showed them on these episodes speaking French with each other, not Italian. So, rewind to 2013, the year in which Nicole Philip, with whom we began this discussion, was experiencing racially motivated bias and mistreatment. It was the same year that Italy instated its first black cabinet minister, Cécile Kyenge. She was at the time an ophthalmologist by profession and a longtime local council member from the northern province of Modena. She arrived in Italy at the age of 19 to study medicine. 10 years later, she married her Italian husband, with whom she now has two grown daughters. The intriguing contradiction here is that while the defilement of Kyenge, a black female politician, reached ritualistic heights, ordinary black women continued to be praised and pursued as bella. This photo that I took of a public notice board on a street in Rome in 2013 is ironic and telling. A triptych of anti-racism posters supporting Kyenge is interrupted by a commercial ad for an exotic festival. A complex of competing aesthetics, contradictory impulses, and paradoxical habits complicate Italy's understanding of its race problem, particularizing it from those of other Western nations such as Britain, France, and the United States. The race and immigration problem is different in one crucial sense. It is unfolding against the backdrop of Italy's mahogany paradox. Thank you.
We have Professor Kristi Grimes from St. Joseph University, and her title of her talk is Diversity and Study Abroad, Roma, Arte, Cultura, Identita. Welcome.
I wanted to thank the Calandra Institute for organizing this symposium, and I wanted to thank all of the panelists and participants. It's truly a pleasure and an honor to learn with and from all of you. What I'm sharing today is very much a work in progress, and so I'm really looking forward to our conversation where we can hopefully exchange challenges and best practices for making study abroad as inclusive and transformative as possible. So intercultural competence and proficiency in a second language are fundamental goals of the liberal arts curriculum at St. Joseph's University, where I teach in Philadelphia. Each July, our Center for International Programs holds a four-week program in Rome. 3 to 4 classes are offered, but only one is conducted in Italian. I began teaching the Italian course 2 years ago. The first year, I followed the established syllabus. The course was a success overall, but it seemed to me that some students behaved more like consumers than learners, dedicating out-of-class time to shopping and selfies for a social media grand tour. So, and here I am with those students. The Institute of International Education reports that 31,000 Americans studied in Italy last year, and yet some programs are not as immersive or as language-intensive as we may wish. Participation does not automatically result in increased competencies. Students often complete coursework in English. Others spend most of their time within a large American cohort and do not use the language beyond the classroom. These factors render meaningful interactions with the target language infrequent or difficult. One afternoon during my first year teaching the course, a student asked me where to find local businesses owned by real Italians. thus igniting a very lively and lengthy conversation. As I listened intently, as my students debated what being Italian means, I was struck by the fact that despite Italy's history and the present reality that was visible to them, that Italian identity seemed understood as homogeneous, or it seemed synonymous with being and understood as white and Catholic. Who is a real Italian is a complex question that dates to the Risorgimento and even earlier. And I think it's reflected in the famous line attributed to D'Azeglio, "We made Italy, now we must make Italians." So the impromptu conversation about Italian identities inspired me to overhaul the course completely. Through research and trial and error, which is ongoing, by the way, I found that focusing on diversity can help students engage in meaningful ways with the cultures of Rome. So diversity-intensive courses are part of our curriculum at St. Joseph's. They aim to help students scrutinize their assumptions about identity and difference while developing awareness of their roles as potential activists for social justice. And this is in accordance with Jesuit values and traditions. These slides show a more detailed description that are on our website. The point I wanted to make is just that diversity courses go through a really rigorous certification process. And faculty have a lot of support in the Office of Teaching and Learning for developing these kinds of courses. So one of the most impactful changes I've been able to make so far involves pre-departure activities. These are designed to help students increase awareness of their own identity and values. Guided assignments can help shape the way in which a student approaches the experience and subsequently impact engagement with the host community. Additionally, pre-departure meetings allow a program leader to measure students' objectives. The literature shows that students maintain different levels of desire for integration, as well as different goals for language learning. The creation of a community of learners during these meetings is essential. Wenger's concept of mutual engagement emphasizes the ways in which community members can support each other while negotiating meaning in a new environment. Investment and accountability are crucial to personal success and to the success of the group. So I changed the course title and updated the content to focus on expanding Italian identities. Student analyzed works by and about multi-ethnic and migrant artists based in Rome, thus exploring intersections among multiple cultures within one city. While reflecting upon the ways in which language, identity, and otherness coexist, students scrutinized assumptions about identity as they compared and contrasted similarities and differences between American cultures and those of Rome. So there are many excellent resources available, and these are two that I used a lot to overhaul the course, and a shout out to Vetri for his excellent monograph. So I made significant changes to the itinerary also in order to contextualize our analysis and to take advantage of Rome as our classroom. For example, after learning about Amiri Sa, we attended a performance. Additionally, we visited publishers that promote multicultural education. Whenever possible, I took students to smaller, less crowded museums and sites. The museum dedicated to the Risorgimento worked really well, both in talking about national identity and also that we were the only people in the museum for like 2 hours. And it was free too, so I mean, it was great. During our visit, we discussed the ways in which Rome has long been a melting pot of diverse peoples and traditions. This painting shows the 1849 battle on the Gianicolo and the participation of Garibaldini of color. And I just want you to take a sec. We could talk about the painting more at during the conversation. I'll this summer get to do some archival research on it. Note that this is a very highly exoticized body also. So earlier I mentioned that the program is comprised of 3 to 4 courses, and we participate in several excursions as a very large group. So there are parts of the itinerary I can't change, but I can modify the approach. We take a trip to Florence, and on that excursion, I focused on connections between the Renaissance and the present day. And to link with our study of migrant artists, I highlighted the African presence in the long 16th century. During this period, newly established trade routes moved between Africa and Europe, and Africans entered Europe more frequently on pilgrimages as members of delegations sent by African rulers and also as slaves. Commissioned by the Medici, this fresco displays the procession of the Magi. Scholars maintain that the man appearing in the retinue of the king was a member of the Medici household. This is Bronzino's portrait of Alessandro de' Medici held in the Uffizi. Artworks such as these raise questions about color, class, and diversity in the Renaissance. An excellent resource is the catalog for the groundbreaking exhibit held in 2013 at the Walters. Revealing the African presence in Renaissance Europe examines the fascination and desire for knowledge and power that characterized European responses to Africa during the early modern period. So to conclude, I want to super briefly outline strategies for an action plan designed to help program leaders increase the participation of students from diverse backgrounds. These recommendations are based on Diversity Abroad Network's Access, Inclusion, and Diversity Roadmap Assessment, which I believe is the only one of its kind. So step one is to start with the data and assess the current state of diversity. It's important to begin by obtaining data from your study abroad or admissions offices. Assessing student participation will help identify areas of success and areas that need improvement. Number two, set collaborative goals to create a strategy. Not all institutions have a specific strategy for diversity and inclusion in study abroad. So collaborate with study abroad offices, diversity offices, student life, scholarship and fellowship offices, the Department of Athletics, whatever offices could be helpful to you, to create a plan with goals and approaches for recruiting, supporting, and retaining students throughout the study abroad experience. Step three regards advising, mentoring, and professional development. So the training and support that staff receive is key. And I'm thinking I want to do an asterisk training for us at St. Joe's. We could really use that. Marketing and recruitment, we don't like to talk about it, but numbers are an issue. We need to have a certain number of students to run the program, right? But we want to develop the right kinds of messages, right? We're not selling a shopping trip, right? So scholarship and funding. So funding is a key barrier to assessing study abroad. It's expensive. So in addition to finding and promoting scholarships, think outside the box and see if you can review systems that can be put into place to make study abroad more affordable. The last one is support while abroad. A critical component of a quality program is that support should not end when students leave campus. And so during our conversation, I'd love to hear just your ideas for best practices, challenges, and what you do to make study abroad more inclusive and transformative. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your presentations. I was impressed by all of them. I have questions. Specifically, the three later presentations discussed kind of programmatic issues with Italian studies, especially at Morgan State University at St. Joe's. And my question is, you've mentioned coursework that you're offering to your students in Italian. Have you had success then having these students come back after they've studied abroad in Rome, or after they've taken their music courses in Italian or in other areas? Have you had them come back then and become minors or majors, and if so, what have you done, or what have you found that works, that then retains them into the program as minors and majors? Thank you.
Usually, so far, I've only taught the course in Italian twice, and next year they're asking me to teach the course in English. So I'm working through that right now. I have to decide by February 15th if I want to do that. Usually the Italian class is comprised of already a group of students. It's the only class with a prereq, which makes it harder to get the right number of students. The English classes have no prereqs, so they're open to the entire university, which is more than 8,000 students, whereas my course is only open to students who have had at least 3 semesters of Italian. Usually they're already on track to be a minor, but if not, that kind of seals the deal for them. What I found is this summer program, it works really well for, say, student athletes, but some students will use it as a stepping stone and then the next year go back for a whole semester. So it has been successful. It's just not that easy to get the right number that our Center for International Programs would like me to be bringing over there.
The challenges are two for a specialty teaching institution like Morgan State University: administrative and economic. So administrative, because Morgan State University used to have a major or minor in foreign language, now current administration, but there is a different approach now to foreign language. It's not offered as a minor, or as a major any longer. So, but there is a requirement for foreign languages in the Morgan State University, so 2 semesters, And in general, that attracts a lot of music majors that want to learn Italian, the grammar. And before it was German, the only option that they would go, because many of the students are in opera, singing, but also gospel music. But I had, I think this is just the first semester, so I had, I think, a good amount of success for the first time. Also because I'm also teaching at Loyola University Maryland full-time there, my schedule was not so flexible, so only I was able only to teach twice per week, so I probably wasn't able to get as many students as I wanted. So about 10, 11, 12, you know, were enrolled. And not all music majors, but also some English majors, biology majors, and engineers usually, which also comprise a big group, they're not required, unfortunately, to take any foreign languages. But now one or two will start Monday, so and I think I have seven, so we close of five or six or seven. And there was discussion with the President Wilson, I don't know if he's listening, who's also a Harvard graduate, to bring up the internationalism for Morgan State. And now the second issue is about economics. Now, I also teach at Loyola University in Maryland, which is a private institution, $50,000 a year. In order to graduate, you have to spend $250,000, $250,000. There's a lot of opportunity for scholarships, but you know the costs are very high. And I have a lot of students from New Jersey, New York, Long Island, in Loyola University Maryland, and also this, I believe, an attempt to make more diverse. Now, Morgan State University is another case. The tuition is low. That's why the academic, as I mentioned, is excellent. So the students, many of them are on financial aid. So right now I'm utilizing Sentieri, which is about $200. So it's difficult. The students don't have the book sometimes for the first month. I give photocopies. And what I'm trying to do now, I reached to the representative from Pearson. I think we were thinking to do a webinar to talk about how to deal with this situation, which is not mentioned. I, you know, kind of the two sides of the coin. In the morning, I teach at Loyola University Maryland, and then I cross the wall, because Baltimore, there is really a physical wall. It's one of the most segregated cities in the United States, as you have probably seen from some of the studies. And I go to Morgan State, different neighborhood, different environment. So I have to adjust. And what I'm doing now, since I work with the Italian-American community, is to raise money for scholarships. So hopefully by spring we will have a couple scholarships going. I'm already involved with this association. We raise about $400,000 a year. Most of those money go they go to Italian-American heritage students. As you know, the Italian-American Association is shrinking because of the participation of the members. They are aging group. We try also to involve more young Italian-Americans. But also I'm trying to introduce this other aspect, the interest of Italian language, which the language is not always connected to the Italian-American mission, as you know, in the association, trying to connect that. And so, yeah, this is nothing. We have to be, we talk about marketing. This is not something that we're trained to do. We go to graduate school, we study all this literature, we try to write our dissertation, and then we try to find a job, we sit there, and everybody, the administration gave us courses, and that's it. I don't know if that is one of the reasons why there is a problem with the Italian program in general, foreign language. We're not used to go out there, try to secure the situation for students, minorities. Often we just worry about our teaching load, preparation. We don't think, now I'm gonna go there trying to get the students. So so this is another important thing that we should discuss, because we are talking about different, different from, I will say, what we used to discuss, especially for historical Black College University. So I'm also trying to recruit, but also not only come to my class. The students don't have the money to get the $200 a book. So wait a second, I'll give you the money with the scholarship. So we have to do that. It's difficult how we do that. I'm learning the ropes, but I think helps if as faculty we join the Italian-American Association in Baltimore. There's many. They really have the mission to help the growth of the Italian-American community, but also the Italian language. So many of my colleagues do not go too much out there in the community. It's important to go in the community, mingle with different heritage groups. We also have a big Jewish community in Parkville, Germans. Now, Italians are number three in terms of ethnic group. It's the largest, third largest group, ethnic group. So this is all thing we have to do. So I'm very practical, try to be practical. I want this to succeed. I want the people to learn Italian. That's my mission, and I will say more than a mission, vocation. So we have to be proactive, and I hope that answers your question. So we don't have just to sit there and hope. We have to get out there, convince the student that this class is going to help them, and they can get a competitive salary. The family also bring the student to the university because of that. And especially the institution like the University of Maryland, as Morgan State, there's specific objectives. So that's what I think will be useful if you can think in these terms. Help the community and connect the study to ethnic pride. Because I connect the study of Italian not only to Italy, but to national United States and America. So,
congratulations to all of you. That was a really lively panel. So I think I have one question, one bigger question. It's a minor one and an observation. So the bigger question is, this conference is going to end with a lot of takeaways, action plans, I think, that groups of us will want to put into effect. And I wanted to, the first question concerns study abroad, where Kristi gave us a great example of how she's adjusted your program at St. Joseph's, and you spoke about what you're doing at Penn. But so the Americans, universities and institutions who are running abroad programs have made adjustments. Is there collective action that we can take that will prompt Italian ministry, in Florence, since there's 40 abroad programs, to become more aware, to encourage them to start some local or national campaign to treat the students better, to be more aware, and to indicate what type of behavior is inappropriate, and dangle before them, we'll send them somewhere else. If Nicole Phillips goes back, if she accepts Dario Nardella's invitation, perhaps Anthony or some of others can encourage her to ask him to do something, and then maybe the other programs. Curiosity question was, is there some sense of the experience of African-American male students abroad? And the last observation had to do with Catherine's comments about the lettore and the response she received on the kind of established Italian Dante group talking about the impenetrability of those lines. It's just that there's such a long tradition in Dante studies of more individual readings. Keats is a very famous example of a very different reading of Inferno 5. And they are not necessarily faithful to the tradition of Dante commentary, but in taking into consideration or at least weighing these other perspectives, and some of them are very far removed, then there is insight to be gained just from that as well.
Maybe I can just complement what you said by adding, I guess, a coda to the presentation I made, in that it's often forgotten that the commedia, and it's, forgive me if this sounds completely heretical, but it's often forgotten that the commedia is a poem, not a historical document, not a philosophical treatise, but a poem. It is poetry, poetic language. And so in the Aristotelian sense, it functions in a universalizing manner rather than specific. When it comes to heterodox readings, as it were, and here the doxology being sort of accepted dogmatic tradition, I think the text invites that. The text is open to what the reader brings to it, and I personally worry when there's any kind of institutional or dogmatic sort of thou shalt consider it this way. You know how in Italian high schools, for example, there are these like bignami readers or what have you that tell them things like Virgil represents human reason and Beatrice represents this and this is represents this and gives them the sort of analogies about what things are supposed to represent so they know what they're supposed to read. And that practice really constrains and shrinks the text and dries it out of its poetic blood life, right? So it's always exciting to read not just a wide range of readings and interpretations, but especially the heterodox ones. You know, one is never obliged to agree with them, but at least they provide some insight about how someone might discover or understand something that the poet has presented us with from a different perspective. So that's all I have to add to that.
If I could just answer to the question of the reception of African American or Black male students. So I alluded to teaching in Italy, but I didn't go into detail about the details of that and what that is. So since 2013, I've taught every summer at John Cabot University, which is in Rome, and it's a U.S. accredited small 4-year college. In the 4 years that I've, the 4 summers that I've taught there, I've never had an African American male student, and I'll be specific. I've had students who are African American male. I'm thinking about one young man in particular. He was not in one of my classes, but he was present in the university. And he was friends with a couple of students of mine, and you know, but he is a 4-year registered student at that university, so he's getting his degree there, and he elected to go there. Whether or not there's a difference there in terms of a semester abroad or year abroad student, and his experience is part of your question, and that's something to explore. Other Black male students that I've encountered that I've personally taught were students who were coming internationally. I had a Zimbabwean student. And I think I should also make this point, and most of you, probably all of you, will be aware of this already, is that there's a very strong, stark gender divide, gender distribution to begin with. So I always have more women students than I do have male students to begin with. And just to sort of contextualize the particularity that I'm calling for in this paper and this study that I put forward, there is a very clear sort of lineage of the Black woman in Italy, from La Venere Nera to various incarnations of this representation. And so it's into a very particular sort of narrative, and quite a lengthy narrative, that Black women in particular enter when they enter Italy, that I would argue is somewhat different for Black men. I'll conclude by saying that one of my first years there, one of my colleagues, a British man who's a Shakespearean, said to me, and he lives there, and he's lived there for years, you know, since college and so on. He's a man in his 50s or 60s at this point. And he said, you know, can I see a Black man in a suit walking around Rome? And his point was the sort of visibility, the encoding of Black masculinity in, at least in Rome, from his experience, is the what is called vocompera, right? The bag sellers and a migrant merchant sort of figure. So I don't know if that helps in terms of
your question.
Thank you for all your presentations. I thought they were awesome. I just had a comment and then a question, and I don't mean to disrespect anybody's experiences or anybody's suggestions, but Ms. Parker said that, and somebody said last night, that we really need to talk to Nardella and we really need to work on the reception in Florence. But I gotta say, it's not just Florence. Florence is not the only problem. A cultural shift in Italy is what's needed, you know? And I have to say that all of us, whether black, white, Asian, thin, fat, etc., we have all been called names in Italy, no matter where we were, right? If you're not Italian, or if you're part Italian and you're not Italian enough, you know? Ancestry DNA would say that I am half Italian. So I just, you know, I did my DNA, and so I know, right? But not enough for actual Italians. So there's a bigger issue, and I think it's great that we want to reach out to the Ministry of Education and we want to talk to Nardella, but I think it's a bigger question than just the education level and just sending, you know, the problem our students have in Florence. And to be honest, Florence is probably not the best option for our students, especially if we want them to learn Italian. It's a microcosm that is a tiny, tiny city compared to all, you know, other options that every single day is not only bombarded by American students and foreign students, but also people getting off the cruise ships to come in for a day and go out. So again, I'm not condoning at all what the Florentines do, but I lived there for 3 years and I can absolutely understand the frustration that they feel. I don't like how they react about it. So I just think the conversation is a lot bigger than us. I think it would be great to change up study abroad in that way and to talk to the Ministry of Education and talk to Nardella, but I think it's gotta be more across the entire country. My question though was, Kristi, you say you're being asked now to teach the class in English and your face just kind of went, you know, I don't want to do that. And I totally understand, because I think every Italian class should be taught in Italian. However, last night we did hear sort of the benefits of teaching them in English. And I have actually, this will be the second year I've done it, I'm teaching a cinema class that is cross-listed in English and in Italian. And this is something you might, I don't know if you've considered it for your study abroad class, but what I do, I have to do all the lectures in English because anybody can enroll in it, has two different course numbers, but the Italian students who want Italian credit have to do all their work, interactions, et cetera, in Italian, and hopefully their research as well. And then the students in the English part of the class do everything in English. So I don't know if you've thought of something like that, but it might be possible to study abroad.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you for the suggestion, it's great. I won't touch the Florence being problematic for study abroad. I'll just say that it's the number one destination by far year after year. And so for me in study abroad, I'm trying to, I think Teddy Roosevelt said, is a quote something like, do what you can with what you have where you are. So I'm just trying to, this one little program that we have, it's 1 month in the summer, it's not a semester. I'm just trying to work on that. My goal is eventually to make it a service learning course. But there's a lot of difficulties with liability and legality there. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying like slowly to change it and just find kind of ways to do it without. So then the semester abroad thing is something that I would love to get more involved in helping change, but we really have, so we send students to like the Fairfield program. So there's really no conversation. But for the English course in the summer, we have some Italian studies courses on campus that they allow us to cross-list like that. I don't know if I can in this case, but I think I'm probably gonna offer an art history class. I just, the whole group being all English speaking, it's just hard. Right, well no, who will go will be like the business class will go and the philosophy class that's a required GEP class. And so what'll happen is I feel like the space for the Italian program and specifically the language piece of the Italian program every year seems, and so at a certain point, I know we have to be adaptive, right? We could quote Darwin here, but we have to adapt. But at the same time, I don't know if I'm ready yet to, but I'll definitely let you know what happens. I have until February 15th. Well, they'll just pick someone else to go, and then there will be truly no Italian component.
There are two more workshops to have here. There's one on racism in Italy. I've already communicated with Nicole Phillips about that and her possible participation. The other is basically doing a type of professional development in teaching things of this sort. There, and perhaps later today we could talk about the sort of missing in action of some of the organizations that have been mentioned.
Thank you, and thank you all for that session. It was great. A couple of observations. One, I think there's a lot of work being done on the intersection of exoticism and eroticism. And I'm reluctant to use that because I think it does disservice to eroticism in a way, even talking about the sort of phenomenon you've been describing there as eroticism. But in any case, there's a lot of work being done, but I think there's more to be done about the way in which Italians perceive the other in terms not of gender and race. So I think there's a really rich seam of for investigation. An observation, and I'm a little bit pessimistic. I've already been speaking to informally with Deborah about this possibility of using leverage, using the American university's leverage to change the culture, because I think it is a culture change. I'm not overly optimistic about that, and yet I think it's something that should be attempted. Within the general context of the normalization of racist discourse in Italy, it's very, very difficult to be optimistic, but I just wanted to, I don't know if you heard, just earlier this week, Roberto Calderoli was actually sentenced to 18 months, albeit suspended, for his comments on Cecile Kayenge and for referring to her as an Arango. Yeah. And I think you're within the overall gloom of the climate of racism in Italy. I think it's in some way encouraging. So having been pessimistic, I like to finish on a slightly optimistic note, that every now and then the courts do seem to do something which restores our faith in that.
Yeah.
Well, thanks. I just have two comments, I think. And first is a little advertisement. There's a great small show here in New York right now till February 6th called Posing Modernity at the new Wallach Gallery on Columbia University's campus, which is up at 125th, in a very interesting and I think a very beautiful building complex designed by Renzo Piano, being designed now. It's fascinating to wander through. He's created a piazza and all sorts of things. But in the gallery there, it's a small gallery, four rooms. There's an exhibit on the black female body in second half of 19th century French impressionist culture, with Manet and Baudelaire sort of at the center. Then it extends to Matisse and into the 20th century, 21st century even. It's very interesting, all inspired by Manet's painting, which is inspired by Titian's painting of Olympia. So there are these interesting Italian connections too, and the Traviata comes in there as well. So there are things to see if you're here and can go see that. So that was a commercial. I was thinking about Catherine's comments about the reader and on Paradise 10, I think Dante empowers you as reader fully to imagine yourself separate from that tradition. He says, there you are, sovra il tuo banco. You've got my book in your hand, and it's your interpretation that matters. This is, again, this kind of radical Dante. He's detached, so radical in the kind of Protestant or protesting sense. You can have your own interpretation and not worry about what's going to come for the next 700 years, or not worried about all the stuff that Dante packs in there. He really does empower the reader in that passage, I think, and it's a great passage. And again, in the African-American tradition, one finds time and time again radical, extraordinary interpretations that have nothing to do with that intellectual tradition, and maybe the best one that I can think of is Spencer Williams, the filmmaker, who ended up being in the TV show Amos and Andy as Andy, who does a 1944 film, Go Down Death, that is, I think, I might argue, one of the most intelligent rereadings of the Inferno I've ever seen, right? And so in that's one example of many that one finds when one moves out of that scholarly commentary tradition. So thank you, and I empower you to keep going.
It's also a cultural issue going on in Italy. Many Italians, as you were rightly mentioned, haven't seen in position of authority or power, I know this word, but in a well-paid position, let's say, they have the specific aesthetic looks of people that are not of a darker complexion. So this is a cultural phenomenon. You may talk to somebody who is 17, 18 years old, and his ideas of race and gender is very backward, not because of ignorance, but because the environment they grew up. So another thing we discuss in Baltimore, I work with the Baltimore County Board of Education. I'm in an unpaid position, unfortunately, in advisory council. Some parents, you know, we try to help and work with different high schools at the public institutions. These are some parents that say, my child in the elementary high school level, they don't see teachers of color, so we need African American in that area to teach. But sometimes African American are not comfortable, you know, to work in an environment where there's not many African Americans, you know that as well. So there's a lot. So how that relates to Italy? That relates to Italy because in Italy, if we are able to bring our students in and create the visibility, how? Well, internships. Let me mention this very important word. I have a lot of students. I don't know you. I have this experience. That come to me. Are there any internship? Medical students. I want to be a doctor. You know, in Baltimore we have the John Hopkins University, a big medical school. Astrophysics. We have the NASA Telescope Institute in between Washington D.C. and the NASA. We are not thinking about creating this connection sometimes. So I will think it's important to bring our passion for Italian, and if we encounter different minorities, it's important to empower them. So there's a side program at Dickinson. There is the Voyage of Discovery for the NIAF. The student who won the Voyage of Discovery. He went to Italy. There is a possibility of teaching English in Italy. And that is, I think that's what we need to think about, not only just to, find a way to meet the curricula, because sometimes you teach the curricula, but maybe that's why we have this rap, the students don't see the logic and the connection between the curriculum and the real life.